الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. All praises are due to Allah, the Creator, the Cherisher, and the Sustainer of this universe. And may His peace and blessings be upon His noble Prophet Muhammad and His descendants and His companions and His followers, dear respected followers of Prophet Muhammad of East London Mosque. Jazakumullah khairan for coming. And I'm really so happy to see you again after a few months from my last talk here about the names of Allah. Today's talk is about Ramadan. It is titled, How to Get Ready for Ramadan Through Understanding the Philosophy of Fasting. All of us are getting ready for Ramadan. Inshallah, within a week, it will start. And all of us have the intention to fast, alhamdulillah. And we told the children that you have to fast. And did any one of us tell the children why will they fast? Or do we ourselves know why will we fast in Ramadan? So we need to understand why are we going to fast. Allah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the command to do a ritual of worship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the rationale behind it to motivate us. For example, salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةِ, and establish the prayer. Why? إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ أَكْبَرِ. Indeed, prayers forbid obscenity and evil. So Allah tells us the rationale behind it. This means that these rituals of worship are not desired by Allah for itself, but rather for the effect of it on us. These rituals of worship are a tarbiyah tool. Every one of them is a tarbiyah tool. It has a tarbiyah effect on what is tarbiyah? We said tarbiyah is to do constant change. That's why usually we use it with children. When someone is doing tarbiyah for his child, it means he is shaping his personality, doing constant change in him, positive change. So these rituals of worship are a tarbiyah tool. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about siyam as a tarbiyah tool. He spoke about fasting as a tarbiyah tool. And he said in Surah Al-Baqarah, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kutiba alaykumus siyamu, kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum, la'allakum tattaqoon. O you who have attained faith, fasting has been prescribed upon you like it was prescribed upon those before you, so that you may attain taqwa, so that you may practice something called taqwa. So it's clear that fasting is the tarbiyah tool that makes us attain taqwa. To understand the philosophy of fasting, then, we need to answer two questions today. Number one, what is taqwa? Number two, what is the relationship between fasting and taqwa? Why didn't Allah use something else to make us attain taqwa? Why didn't Allah use salah to make us attain taqwa? Why not hajj? Why not zakah? Why not being kind to the parents? Why not all these obligations? Why did Allah choose fasting particularly and link it to taqwa? And tell us that if you fast, you, in Ramadan especially, you will attain taqwa. Because the next ayah says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. It's the month of Ramadan in which the Quran has been sent down. And then Allah says that the one of you who reaches this month should fast it. Number one, what is taqwa? Some people may think taqwa is God-fearing. And also it is actually translated into God-fearing in many translations of the Quran. But actually, God-fearing in Arabic is خشية. خشيةullah, not تقوى الله. خشيةullah is God-fearing. Why would anyone fear the anger of God or the punishment of God? Why would God punish anyone? For the sins that he committed. Good. So God-fearing or خشيةullah deals with past sins that were committed. And khashya is not taqwa. Why not? Maybe they are synonyms. Mutaradifat, many words can be synonyms. Khashya is not a synonym of taqwa. How can we know that? In Surah An-Nur, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَخْشَ اللَّهَ وَيَتَّقِهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. Those who obey Allah and His Messenger, listen to this, and have God-fearing and have taqwa, are the triumphants. When you find the word and, wa in Arabic, it denotes that what comes before it is different from what comes after it. I can't say Fadel and Fadel, but I can say Fadel and Fadi, because what came before the and is different from what comes after the and. So when Allah says, those who fear God and do taqwa God, taqwa from God, it means that khashya, fearing, is not taqwa. Khashya is not taqwa. We said khashya is what? Is to fear the anger of God or the punishment of God for the sins committed already in the past. What is taqwa then? Taqwa comes from the root in Arabic waqa, which means to protect. So taqwa Allah, it is to protect yourself against the punishment of God or the anger of God. How can one protect himself against the anger of God? Why would God be angry of people when they commit sins? So when you want to protect yourself, when you want to avoid God's anger, you should not fall in sins. Therefore, taqwa is to be mindful of God so that you don't fall in sins. We're talking about future sins that are not committed yet. Taqwa, therefore, taqwa deals with future sins that are not committed yet. Khashyatullah deals with past sins that were committed already. So regarding the past sins, people should have God-fearing. Regarding the sins that were not committed, you should be mindful of God to protect yourself against his anger. In order to avoid his anger. Done? So that's clear. Taqwa Allah deals with future sins that are not committed yet by being mindful of God all the time. Good. The second question then, what is the relationship? What is the relationship between taqwa and fasting? God said in Surah Al-Baqarah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O you who have attained faith, fasting has been prescribed upon you like it was prescribed upon those before you, so that you may be mindful of God. What does fasting have to do with being mindful of God? Here you need to imagine. Imagine yourself. By the way, imagination is very important for understanding the religion. You know, imagination is more important than knowledge. Who said that? Imagination is more important than knowledge. Did you ever hear this before? Okay. No one knows? Albert Einstein, but anyway. Imagination is so important. Imagine yourself at the beginning of a fasting day. Imagine that You just had your suhoor or your sahur. By the way, this is a tip for you. The process of eating your last meal, it is called the suhoor. The food itself you eat is the sahur. The process of making wudu is called the wudu. The water used in wudu is called the wadu. Imagine that you just ate your sahur and you prayed fajr and you are now starting your fasting day. Imagine that. What do you think you're thinking about now?
Yeah, that's the problem.
What are you focusing upon in the beginning of a fasting day? Are you focusing upon past days? Are you thinking much about the last few days that you fasted and what happened in them? No, you're focusing on this day that is starting. Focusing on not to do any mistake that nullifies your fasting. Not to swallow a drop of water by mistake during the wudu or when you have a bath. Not to swallow by mistake a crumb of food or something if you're tasting the food with your tongue or the lips when you're cooking for your children, because you can do that. You can, you know, some people, when they are like cooking rice especially, they want to test it and see if the rice is cooked or not. So they can taste it with their lips or with their tongue, but they should not swallow it. If you swallow it, done. You nullified your fasting that day. So at the beginning of a fasting day, you are so careful not to do any mistakes that nullifies your fasting. You're also careful not to do any mistakes that makes your fasting unaccepted by God. You always want to be calm, peaceful. If someone harasses you or something, you have to be peaceful and say, I'm fasting. You have to lower your gaze. So you, in the beginning of a fasting day, you are always thinking of what's coming. You don't look back. Next day, you take your suhoor, pray your fajr, and you start thinking of what's coming. You don't look back. Next day, think about what's coming. Don't look back. Think about what's coming. Don't look back. Always think about the future. Don't do any mistakes in the future. What did we say taqwa is? To be mindful of God, not to fall in future sins. Therefore, fasting is a training course that programs your mindset on always focusing on what's coming and not looking back. So now we understood why fasting, especially fasting particularly, can help you attain taqwa. Okay, that's good, but shouldn't we remember our sins, our past sins, and remorse? Many people think that remorse and regretting the sins is to remember the. No, I don't want you to remember the incident. We want to forget the incident, but you know that you committed a certain sin. So to be mindful of God, a part of being mindful of God is to remorse it. When you say, I will never, ever again do that sin, and you keep in mind that you don't fall in it ever again, in a sense, you are remorsing it. And the good news is, we have good news in Surah At-Talaq. Though the surah is called the divorce talaq, and when you hear that there is some talaq happened, it's not good news, but there's good news in this surah. In verse number 5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يُكَفِّرْ عَنْهُ سَيِّئَاتِهِ وَيُعْظِمْ لَهُ أَجْرًا. The one who attains taqwa, the one who is mindful of God, Allah will forgive his sins. Which sins is going God to forgive? The sins you didn't do? No, the sins you did already. So if you keep God in mind and you are mindful of God that you don't fall in future sins, God will forgive your past sins. Is that it? No, that's not it. وَيُعْظِمْ لَهُ أَجْرًا, and he will multiply his reward. Just being mindful of God, not to fall in sins, makes Allah forgive you your past sins, and he keeps rewarding you as if you're like giving in charity with your right hand and the left hand. SubhanAllah. It's important to be muttaqeen. When I say to be muttaqeen, I'm speaking about a group of people that were mentioned in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning of the Quran, after Surah Al-Fatiha, comes Surah Al-Baqarah. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about three groups of people. Al-Muttaqeen, the mindful of God, and Al-Kafirin, the deniers, and the third is Al-Munafiqeen, the hypocrites. The hypocrites in 13 verses. The kafirin, the deniers, in 2 verses. And the muttaqin in 4 verses. Where is the believers? Allah chose from among the believers the elite among them. And he spoke about them. The muttaqin are not any believers. It is the elite among the believers. The elite are not those who drive Rolls Royce. The elite are those who are mindful of God all the time. Those are the elite. Allah spoke about them in the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. Alif Lam Mim. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. Alif Lam Mim. That is the book in which there is no doubt about it. The first characteristic is what? Of course they pray. Of course they spend in charity, but the first characteristic is not one of those. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. A guidance for the muttaqeen, a guidance for the mindful of God. الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who believe in the hidden realms. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ. And they establish the prayer. وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. And from what we have provided for them, they spend. So they establish the prayers and they spend in charity. But number one is they believe in the hidden realms, which means they believe that their intellect, their minds are limited. There are things that they cannot see. There are things that they cannot hear. There are things that they cannot understand. But they have trust in God that He's wise. No matter what happens, there is wisdom, even if we don't understand. This keeps you always mindful of God. We listen to what God says and we implement it. Whether we understand the wisdom or not, it's good to always try to understand the wisdom. The Quran encourages you all the time to try to understand the wisdom. But also the Quran told you that you were not given from knowledge except what's very little. Which means you will not reach all wisdom. You will not reach all the wisdom. Can one of us understand all the wisdom of a genius like Einstein, for example? So what about the wisdom of God then? Why do you think that you have to understand every single thing? You will not. But the Quran encourages you to seek knowledge and to try to find the wisdom. That's why I always say the smartest person is the one who tries to understand everything. And the dumbest is the one who thinks that he can understand everything. Try to understand. Therefore, from what we have said so far, focus on the future to rectify both the future and the past altogether. Like that, you can be among the muttaqeen. And don't despair. No matter what you have done, what did you do? You cheated? You lied? You committed adultery? All of this can be fixed. All of this can be fixed if you start now having taqwa. If you start keeping God in mind all the time and be mindful of God, not to fall in these sins again. Listen to the verses of the Quran. Listen to the words of God. He says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And hasten towards forgiveness from your Lord and a garden as wide as the heavens and the earth prepared for those who are mindful. Those who give in prosperity and adversity, and those who restrain anger, and those who forgive mankind. And Allah loves those who excel in doing good. And listen to this. وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً. And those who, if they commit a fahisha. Among the meanings of fahisha is illegal sex. Oof. Allah is describing the muttaqin by the people who, if they commit an obscenity, and it can be illegal sex, they remember Allah. Dhakarullah. They remember Allah. And ask forgiveness. ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ وَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ. And ask forgiveness for their misdeeds. وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And who forgives misdeeds except Allah? Allah is asking this question. Allah says it as a question. And who forgives misdeeds except Allah? Doesn't mean that Allah needs an answer from us. It means Allah is telling you, utilize your intellect. No one forgives all sins except Allah. Even if you do no matter anything to your brother or your sister or your wife or whatever, and they tell you, we forgive you, it will not be 100% forgiveness. There is something still. There is some pain at least in the heart. And you know what? Even when they forgive you because it makes them feel better. Allah doesn't forgive you to feel better. Allah forgives you because He loves forgiveness. You understand this or not? Those who forgive you and they benefit from this forgiveness because it makes them better that they forgive. So, we are 1 week away from Ramadan. We need to put a plan. Put a plan in order to come out from Ramadan like a born again Muslim. A Muslim who's born again and a brand new human being. How can we do that? Number one, how can we get close to God? How can we be among the mindful of God, the elite? Number one, you need to know what you are doing. What are we about to do? Abstain from eating and drinking and sexual activities with our spouses from dawn until sunset, which is lawful. So we are sacrificing for God to show Him that we remember Him. We are glad to sacrifice for Him. We are appreciating His bounty on us. Because the problem is, people don't remember what they have except when they lose it. People don't remember the ni'mah, the grace of God, except when they lose it. So what we do is we deprive ourselves from the ni'mah so that we can appreciate it. Siyam is what? One of the pillars of Islam. To fast the month of Ramadan for those who can, health-wise. But it's a pillar of Islam. So when you speak about Siyam, you need to speak with respect. ذَلِكَ وَمَن يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we should show respect to the sha'air of Allah. Not make fun of it. Some of us sometimes, though they are religious and they fast, but they make fun of the ritual sometimes. They speak with disrespect. So be careful with that. Second, you need to check. You need to have the akhlaq as-sa'im, the character of the صائم, the fasting person. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ليس الصيام من الأكل والشرب وإنما الصيام من اللغو والرفث. He said, صيام, fasting, is not from eating and drinking, not from food and drink, but rather from indecent acts and speech. So, number one, you need to look at your relationship with your family. You need to fix it before Ramadan, before you start. You need to forgive people. You need to remove all the grudges that you have in your heart towards anyone. Your family, your friends, your neighbors, everybody. It's better for you. And then you need to know that. Put in mind that if someone harasses you verbally, you just say peace. The Prophet ﷺ said, فَإِنْ سَابَّكَ أَحَدٌ أَوْ جَهِلَ عَلَيْكَ فَقُلْ إِنِّي صَائِمٌ. If someone harasses you verbally or curses you, just say, I am fasting. Remind yourself that you're fasting. And also it's a message for him that you can respond, but you're Muslim. You're not going to do that. The same tongue that says, La ilaha illallah, alhamdulillah, astaghfirullah, cannot say bad words. Cannot say obscene words. Should be careful with your speech. And the Prophet continued and said, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعِ وَرُبَّ قَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ قِيَامِهِ إِلَّا السَّهْرِ. How many are those who fast and get nothing from their fasting except hunger, which means they are not rewarded? And how many are those who pray at night and get nothing from their prayer but sleeplessness? Be careful, Taraweeh is starting. Some people brag by going to Taraweeh. Some people show off because they go to Taraweeh. Mentioned here in the hadith. How many are those who stand up in prayer at night and they benefit nothing except sleeplessness? Be careful. We all do good deeds, I know, wallahi. But very few of us do it for the sake of Allah. Be careful. You need to know that in this month of Ramadan, any nafila means any extra good deed, like the sunnah that you pray, any nafila, any extra good deed is as rewardable as an obligation. And any obligation you do is as rewardable as 70 obligations. Very rewardable. You can collect a lot of rewards, mashallah. And in this month of Ramadan, you can become among the Ahlul Quran, the family of the Quran. On the Day of Judgment, there are those who will stand up and the label they have is Ahlul Quran, the family of the Quran. Would you like to be one of those? The one who wants to be one of the Ahlul Quran, raise your hand. Don't worry, raise your hand. Wallah, I can tell you how you can do that during this Ramadan. Because some people think that Ahlul Quran are those who memorize the whole Quran by heart. Though Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, in his book Muftah Dar al-Sa'adah, The Key to Jannah, he said, أهل القرآن هم العالمون به العاملون بما فيه وإن لم يحفظوه عن ظهر قلب. He said, أهل القرآن, the family of the Quran are those who are knowledgeable, who have knowledge about it and apply it in their life, even if they do not memorize it by heart. But as for the one who memorizes it without comprehending it, nor did he or she apply it, then they are not from the people of the Quran, no matter how much they pronounce it properly. So someone can be a memorizer of the whole Quran and pronounce it properly, recites it beautifully, and come on Judgment Day and doesn't find himself among the people of the Quran. Can you imagine this? Why? Because he did not comprehend it or apply it in his life. Why do people memorize anything? To apply it. When someone tells me, how can I go to Stratford from here? I tell him, take that exit, walk right, another right, and then cross the street, take bus number 25 towards Ilford. After 12 stops, you are in Stratford. Did you memorize? Yes, I memorized. Recite. I go out from this exit, I make right, right, cross the street, take 25 towards Ilford, 12 stops, I'm in Stratford. Good. Apply. People memorize to apply. What about those who just memorize for the sake of memorization? And some people memorize to show off with their memorization. Memorization is good and important. But the more important is to comprehend it and apply it in our life. And then Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah continues saying, فَقِرَاءَةُ سُورَةٍ بِتَدَبُّرٍ وَمَعْرِفَةٍ وَجَمْعِ قَلْبٍ أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ قِرَاءَةِ خَتْمَةٍ سَرْدًا. The recitation of one surah with, listen to this, pondering, feeling its meanings in one's heart, is dearer to Allah than a whole quick khatmah, than reading the Quran, all of it, completing it from Al-Fatiha to An-Nas, but quickly without comprehension. Okay, we need to know now what to do regarding the Quran during this Ramadan. Listen, it's a long day. It's a long day. So we have time, alhamdulillah. What will distract you is a horrible machine in your house called TV. I suggest you put it in a box and you make four takbirs. Okay? And the YouTube app, you can also delete it. Alas, tell me, there's a lot of religious episodes and religious shows in Ramadan. Watch it after Ramadan. Okay? Including mine. So, at least 2 hours for the Quran. Every day, 2 hours. Excluding the Taraweeh. In addition to the Taraweeh. But there should be 2 hours with the Book of Allah. In the last 10 verses of Surah Al-Furqan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-Furqan, I think Surah number 23, eh? Or 25. I think 25. Last 10 verses, Allah speaks about a group of people called Ibadur Rahman. The worshippers of Ar-Rahman. The worshippers of the All-Merciful. And Allah tells us the character, the characteristics of those Ibad al-Rahman. How can you be one of them if you have this character? They have 12 characteristics mentioned in the last 10 verses. وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. To the end of the surah. Ibad al-Rahman are those who walk on earth humbly, so they are humble. And if they are harassed by an ignorant harasser, they just say peace, which means they are peaceful. And among the character of Ibad al-Rahman is a very important one. It is, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِّرُوا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ لَمْ يَخِرُّوا عَلَيْهَا صُمَّا وَعُمْيَانًا. They are those who, when they are reminded with the verses of their Lord, they do not fall on them deaf and blind. Which means if they read the Quran or if they hear the Quran, they interact with it. They don't deal with it with like deaf and blind. No, they interact with the Quran. Which means, please concentrate. Well, I'm like 5 minutes away from finishing today. But this is the most important 5 minutes. It can change your life because you will learn now how to ponder the Quran spiritually, which can turn the Quran. It doesn't turn the Quran, but it will turn your heart into a living being inside your chest. Because the Quran is what? It's not ink on paper. No. The Quran is so peculiar. Every book in the world was written in this world for the world to read it. But the Quran is different. هو تنزيل رب العالمين. تنزيل. It is a bestowal from on high by the Lord of the worlds. So the Quran descended on the world from outside the world. We're not dealing with anything. It is a spirit, not just words. It's a spirit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا. Allah tells Prophet Muhammad, I have revealed to you a spirit by my command. What is the difference between a living person and a dead person? Both have bodies. The living person has a spirit, has a soul, but the dead doesn't have a spirit. So the Quran is a spirit if it gets into your dead heart. It will revive it and give it life. Wallahi, listen to those few minutes now, and you will learn how to give life to your heart. Number one, if you read, when you come across a verse mentioning Jannah, paradise, the gardens, whatever, don't continue. Stop. And in your heart, ask Allah, Jannah. And then you come across a verse that talks about chastisement, Jahannam, hellfire, torment. Don't continue, stop. And in your heart, ask Allah to save you from this. And then you come across a verse that talks about a group of people like Al-Muttaqeen, the mindful of God. As-Salihin, those who excel in doing good. Al-Aamileen, the workers. Don't continue, stop. And in your heart, ask Allah to be among this group. And then you come across a verse that mentions another group like Al-Munafiqeen, the hypocrites. Al-Kafirin, the deniers. Stop and ask Allah to save you from being one of this group. Like that, you are interacting with every verse in the Quran. Every verse, you can interact with it. Every Quranic sentence, you can interact with it. Now let's take an example, and I'll show you how to do that together. First of all, I know that we are three groups. A group that reads Arabic and understands Arabic. Good. Then you have no problem at all. Read the Quran in Arabic, you understand it in Arabic. A group that knows how to read Arabic, but they don't understand it. They learn just to put letters next to each other and like that. It's not enough to read the Arabic. You have to read the translation as well. So you read 3, 4, 5 verses in Arabic and you read them in English, the translation, in order to ponder. How can you ask Allah to be among a group if you don't know which group is this? Okay? So you need to ponder. Those who don't know Arabic at all, you need to read the translation. The translation is not the Quran. Yes, of course, it's not the Quran, but it has guidance. Thousands and thousands of people have read the translation of the meanings of the Quran, which is not the Quran, and they were guided to Islam, right or not? So if you don't know Arabic at all, you have to read from the translation. If you know Arabic but you don't understand it, you also have to read from the translation as well as the Arabic. If you know Arabic and understand it, you have no problem. Now, let's take an example. And I will read it in English for you. To prove to you that you can ponder the Quran spiritually from the English. And obey Allah and the Messenger that you may obtain mercy. And raise towards forgiveness from your Lord. No, that's too fast. Too fast. I said, and obey Allah and the Messenger that you may obtain mercy. Stop and ask Allah to be among those who obtain mercy. So when I read it like that, and obey Allah and the Messenger that you may obtain mercy. I stop. And in my heart I say, O Allah, make me among those who obtain your mercy. And then I continue. And raise towards forgiveness from your Lord and a garden as wide as the heavens and the earth. prepared for those who are mindful of God. I have to stop. And in my heart, I ask Allah, oh Allah, make me among those who are mindful of you. And then I continue. Those who give in prosperity and adversity, and those who restrain anger, and those who forgive mankind, and Allah loves those who excel in doing good. Wallahi, I don't know how can anyone read this and continue reading. Did you hear what was said? This is breaking news. It says, and Allah loves those who excel in doing good. Allah told us who does He love. How can anyone continue without stopping and saying, oh God, make me among those whom you love. Ya Rab, Ya Rab, Wallahi, and cry. Allah told you, who does He love? How can you continue without asking Allah in your heart to be among them? This is what the verse in Surah Al-Furqan says. When they interact with the Quran, they don't fall on it deaf and blind, which means they interact with it. The Quran will deal with the feelings of your heart like that. Like that, it acts as a spirit that revives your heart. And continue. Those, their reward is forgiveness from their Lord and gardens beneath which rivers flow, abiding therein forever. How good is the reward of the workers? I have to stop and say, oh Allah, make me among those workers. Make me among those who will be rewarded with forgiveness. Like that. You have to all the time do that. For example, the next one says, many societies have passed away before you, so travel the earth and note the fate of the disbelievers. Stop and ask, oh Allah, make me die as a Muslim. Oh Allah, make me not die as a disbeliever. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from being considered as a disbeliever. This is a proclamation to humanity and guidance and advice for those who are mindful of God. Ask Allah. So literally every single verse of the Quran, you can deal with it like that by making it a dua. A dua. You can make a dua from every verse in the Quran. Guys, we don't drink, right? Why don't we drink? One of the reasons why we don't drink is to understand the Quran. Allah said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى حَتَّى تَعْلَمُوا مَا تَقُولُونَ. All you who have attained faith, do not approach prayer while you are drunk in order to understand what you are saying. So one of the reasons why we don't drink is to understand the Quran. Subhanallah. We neither drink nor we understand the Quran. How can that be? How can that be? This book is so valuable, but the way we treat it is not doing justice to it. Okay?